So there will be I will mostly talk about results obtained in the first paper and in the third paper, and I will stick to the case where the best field is the field of real numbers, but part of what I will say is actually valid over any perfect best field. Okay, so but it's just easier to stick to the case of real numbers. Okay, so first let me recall the classical setting concerning the notions of real structures, real loci, and real forms. So let's start with X, a complex algebraic variety. A real structure on X is an anti-regular involution, which means a scheme involution such that the following diagram commutes. Two real structures are called mu1 and mu2. They are called equivalent if they are conjugate by a regular automorphism. So you can find a phi such that mu2 equals phi mu1 phi minus 1. Then you say that mu1 and mu2 are equivalent. When you have an equivalent real structure, you can define its real locus, which is simply the set of fixed points. So this set can be empty, but for me, it's not a problem at all. And finally, there is a notion of real form. A real form of a complex algebraic variety X is a real algebraic variety X0 together with an isomorphism. So you have the following isomorphism. Most of the time when you talk about a real form, you just mention X0 and you forget about the isomorphism, but you have to keep in mind that a real form is really a pair. You have two things. And this fiber product simply means that if you think about X0 as given locally given by polynomial equations with real coefficients, now you consider these coefficients as complex coefficients, and you get a complex variety, which is the one denoted, which is this one, okay? And you want this one to be isomorphic to X. So now you may wonder, what is the relation between the notion of real structure on the one hand and the notion of real form on the other hand? The answer comes from the following result, which mostly follows from the work of Weil and Borel-Serre, and which tells the following. There is an equivalence of categories between, on the one hand, the real quasi-projective varieties, and on the other hand, the complex quasi-projective varieties endowed with a real structure. Okay, so how does it go? If you start with X0, a real variety, you can always complexify as before. So you can do this fiber product thing. So you can do a base change of the at the level of scalar, and you get a complex variety. But this complex variety does not come alone. It comes with a real structure, which is simply the one induced by the complex conjugation on the second factor. Okay. In the other direction, if you start with a complex variety with a real structure mu, then you can think about mu as being a Z mod 2Z group action on X, because it's an involution. And so you can do the quotient. And this quotient in general is an algebraic space, but here I'm working in the category of quasi-projective varieties. So when I do the quotient, I get a real variety. And moreover, two real varieties, X mod mu1 and X mod mu2, they are isomorphic if and only if mu1 and mu2 are equivalent. So in fact, in the previous definition, there was the notion of real forms and the notion of real structures and the equivalence relations. And those are the two sides of the same coin. You have the real form and the isomorphism classes, and you have the real structure and the equivalent classes. Those are the same things. But from a geometric point of view, what is interesting is the notion of real form. But when you do computations, it's much easier to work with real structures. So at least that's my feeling. And so that's why this is a point of view that one uses to state theorem, for instance. Okay. And here, just one remark. So one thing that I mentioned already is that here, if I put the quasi-projectivity assumption, it's to ensure that this quotient exists not only as an algebraic space, because it always exists as an algebraic space, but in general, it may not be a real algebra. It may not be an algebraic variety. If you want this to be an algebraic variety, you need this descent datum to be effective, which means you need actually what you really need is X to be covered by an open subset, by open subset, by quasi-projective open subset stable for stable by mu. Okay, so you don't really need a quasi-projective varieties, but you need a quasi-projective cover mu stable. So it's easier to make this global assumption. This global assumption is simply to ensure that this quotient is in the good category. Okay. So this is a technical thing. I just mentioned it because it will come back later, but it's not so important at the moment. Let's do examples. I plan to do many examples in this talk. So you start with X, the projective line, then up to equivalence, X has exactly two real structure. So the first one is P1 of R. The real locus is P1 of R. You can take X, Y is mapped to X bar, Y bar. Then you can compute the real locus, you get P1 of R. And the corresponding real form is a rational conic, so the conic given by this equation. But there is another one. You can take also X, Y is mapped to minus Y bar, X bar. Then the real locus is the empty set. This is easy to check from this. And the corresponding real form is a so-called empty conic. Empty because there is no real points, but still it's a nice real scheme, a real projective scheme of dimension one. Okay, and up to equivalence, there is nothing more. This is easy to check from the fact that the automorphism group of P1 is PGL2. So playing a bit with the notion of real structure, you can prove that there is nothing else. And now the two key questions in this business are the following. The first question is an existence problem. For a given complex variety, does there exist a real structure on X? Yes, no. The second question is an enumerative problem. If you have one, how many real structures up to equivalence does the complex variety X carry? And when is this number finite? Okay, so you really have those two questions are very different in nature. And also the answer depends strongly on X. But even if it depends strongly on X, there is still a general strategy to answer the second question, which is summarized in the following theorem, which is, to be honest, more a useful observation than a theorem because it's very easy to prove. It's just a reformulation. Let X be a complex variety endowed with a real structure mu. So you need to have one for what will follow. Then the set of equivalent classes of real structures on X are in bijection with the first set of Galois cohomology H1 gamma ot CX. So this is my Galois group. This is Z mod 2Z. And this Galois group, it acts on this group as follows. If gamma is a non-trivial element of the Galois group, you define gamma dot phi to be the conjugation by mu. So here I didn't put minus one because it's an involution, but this is really a conjugation. And since this is anti-regular, regular, anti-regular, this whole thing is of course regular. So you really get a well-defined Galois action on this group, and then you consider the group cohomology. It's called Galois cohomology because you put a Galois group, but this is simply the group cohomology. And the set that you define here, you can easily prove that it is it corresponds to the equivalent classes of real structure on X. Okay, and the interest of this reformulation is that now you can use all the cohomology toolbox. You can do exact sequences, you can use some classical results to prove the finiteness of this set and so on. And using applying this kind of ideas, one can show the finiteness of the number of real structures for instance, certain families of projective surfaces. So here you have a lot of results. I don't go into details, but a lot of things. And this is still a very active area. You have the finiteness whenever ot x mod ot zero x is finite or arithmetic. So this is a group of components. This concerns, for instance, the varieties of general types, the abelian varieties, or the Fano varieties. So for all these varieties, we know that this set is finite, and so there is always a finite number of non-isomorphic real forms. There is also a result for hyperkala varieties due to Cataneo and Fu, and so on. But a striking fact is that the first examples of projective varieties having infinitely many non-isomorphic real forms are very recent. This is the work of Lesieutre and Dino Guizzo. And very recently, there is a work concerning the by Oguizo and Dean, and a third one, I think, concerning the number of real form for rational projective surfaces. They obtain example with infinitely many non-isomorphic real forms. And so this is the picture for in the projective setting. But there are analogous results in the affine setting. Here I think, for instance, about the results obtained by Duboulot, Freudenberg, and Moser-Josselin concerning the smooth rational affine varieties of dimension at least 4 with infinitely many non-isomorphic real forms. Okay. So here I focused on the case of projective varieties, but in the affine case there are also a lot of results. So this is the picture in the classical setting. And again, the two key questions are these two here, 1 and 2, okay? So this was all I wanted to say about the classical setting. Now, I would like to consider varieties with algebraic group actions. And so I will modify slightly the framework and the previous definition. But if there are questions so far, please feel free to ask. No questions, so I continue. So now I will consider varieties with group actions. So first, I need to consider real forms on algebraic groups. Let me start with the following definition lemma. Let G be a complex algebraic group. If sigma is a real group structure, which means, as before, a real structure which is furthermore a group involution on GC, then when you do the quotient, when you consider this as before, what you get is not only a real algebraic variety, it's in fact a real algebraic group. Okay. A priori, when you do the quotient of a complex algebraic group by a real structure, what you get is a real algebraic variety. But if this real group, this real structure is a bit special, so here it must preserve the group structure of the set of complex points, then what you get is in fact endowed with a group structure. For instance, you can consider the multiplicative group. It admits three non-equivalent real structures. There is T map to T bar, then it corresponds to the group GMR. You have T maps to T minus 1 bar, then the corresponding real group is a circle S1 or SO2R if you prefer. But there is a third one, which is not a real group structure. You map T to minus T minus 1 bar, then you can check that the real locus is empty. So in particular, for real group structure, one must be a fixed point, so the real locus cannot be empty. So if the real locus is empty, this cannot be a real group structure. Okay, and one can check using the fact that the automorphism group of GMT is small. one can check that there is nothing else. Okay, and now similarly, if you take G equals SL2 of C. You have exactly two real group structures. You have SL2 of R and you have SU2C corresponding to G maps to G bar and G maps to transpose G minus 1 bar. Those are certainly inequivalent since this one is compact and not this one. And in fact, you can check there is nothing else. But of course, there are also real structures which are not real group structures. You can take, for instance, G maps to minus G bar. And then one is maps to, is sends to minus 1, so it's not a real group structure. Okay. So this is just something I will need after, but it's not the main dish because the notion of real group structure is very well understood. Okay, for complex reductive algebraic groups, you can reduce to the case of tori and simple groups. And for tori, there is an explicit description. For simple groups, there are tables. So you can this is well known. If you give me your favorite reductive algebraic group, I can tell you all the real group structure on it. Okay. Now what I want to talk about is the notion of equivalent real structure. So let G sigma be a complex algebraic group endowed with a real group structure, which means that I fixed G, a complex algebraic group, and sigma is a real group structure as before, so it is the same thing as to consider a real algebraic group. Okay. And now, given X, a complex G variety, a G sigma equivalent real structure on X is a real structure mu on X, so as before, an anti-regular scheme involution, such that, so anti-regular means again that you have a commutative diagram, and at the bottom you have a spec of Z maps to Z bar. But you want here something more. You want a sigma linearity, meaning for every g and every x, you want mu of g dot x equals sigma g dot mu x. This condition means, in fact, that when you do the quotient x mod mu, call it x zero, this quotient is endowed with a g zero action. So if you denote by g zero the real algebraic group G mod sigma, where sigma is here, then you obtain a real algebraic variety endowed with a G0 action, such that when you complexify, you get back to X as a G variety. Okay, so you have X and G which are given, and you fix G0, and you are looking for all the possible X0, such that when you complexify, you get back to G acting on X. And of course, you can define equivalent real structure. You will say that two equivariant real structures are equivalent if they are conjugated by a G equivariant regular automorphism. And you will have, in this case, you will have X mod mu 1 isomorphic to X mod mu 2 as a G0 variety if and only if mu 1 and mu 2 are conjugate. And so you can certainly has the same question as before. For a given complex G variety, does there exist an equivalent real structure on X? If yes, how many up to equivalence? And is this number finite? So the exact same question as before, but before I told you the answer depends on X, strongly on X. Here it depends on X, but it also depends on G, so on the X seen as a G variety. And furthermore, it depends on sigma. Okay, we will see that for different sigma, we obtain different answers to both questions. Indeed, let's illustrate this dependency relation with examples. If you take P1 as before, but now seen as a G variety, where G is a multiplicative group acting as follows. So this is just an example. You can take any toric structure on P1, it will give you the same result. We just saw that G admits two inequivalent real group structures, which are GMR, T maps to T bar, and S1, so T maps to T minus 1 bar. Then one can show that X admits a unique G sigma 0 equivalent real structure. So there is a unique real form of P1 which is endowed with an action of GMR, which is P1R with the same formula. But there are exactly two inequivalent G sigma 1 equivalent real structure on X. So it means that there are two non-isomorphic real form of P1 endowed with an action of S1. Indeed, P1 of R and the empty conic. So here it tells you that the answer to question B, the number of real structures, depends on sigma zero, depends on sigma. For sigma zero and sigma one, you don't get the same answer. And now the first example will show you that the answer to the first question also depends on sigma. Indeed, take x equals the affine plane endowed with a natural action of SL2 of C, so just the multiplication matrix times vector. Then I told you G admits two inequivalent real group structures, which are G maps to G bar, so this corresponds to SL2 of R, and G maps to transpose of G minus 1 bar, this corresponds to SU2. Then one can show that X admits a unique G theta 0 equivalent real structure. So there is a unique real form of X with an action of SL2 of R, namely A2R with a natural action. But there is no real form of X with an action of SU2, such that when you complexify, you get back to this. Okay. So here, this is an example where the answer to the second question is yes, to the first question, sorry, is yes for theta 0, but no for theta 1, even if x and g are the same. So now we have to keep that in mind when we are tackling these problems of answering the two key questions. We have really to be careful with what is g, what is sigma. Okay. And now I can tell you what we did with Lucie Moser-Josselin and Mikhail Bulois and Mirai Borovoy. What we did is to answer the two key questions for certain families of algebraic varieties endowed with an algebraic group actions. More precisely, we gave a complete answer to the first question for almost homogeneous varieties over any perfect base field. Here by almost homogeneous variety, I mean an algebraic variety endowed with a reductive group action which acts with a dense open orbit. Okay. And for the second question, we did not get a full answer, but we obtained a partial answer over the field of real numbers for certain families of almost homogeneous varieties. And what I will do now is to give you a sample of our results. I will consider two particular cases. First, the case of orospherical varieties, and then the case of almost homogeneous SL2 threefolds. Okay, so let's do this. Mm-hmm. Okay, so before I go on, are there questions about the framework? I hope everyone can hear me. Yes?
We hear you.
Okay, good. So I go on. So let me talk about orospherical varieties. Let G be a complex reductive algebraic group. So think about GLN, SLN, or torus, whatever you like. Then a complex G variety is said to be orospherical if it has an open orbit whose stabilizer contains a maximal unipotent subgroup U of G. Okay, so the first time you see this definition, it's not so easy to understand to interpret the geometric meaning of this assumption. Let me give you examples first. You can consider toric varieties. Those are orospherical varieties because in this case, the maximal unipotent subgroup is trivial. Okay. So if you take G equals GLN of C, a maximal unipotent subgroup is given, for instance, by taking upper triangular matrices with one on the diagonal. Okay. And any maximal unipotent subgroup of GLN is conjugate to this. It's just to have a clear picture in mind. So you have the example of toric varieties. You have the example of flag varieties, which are G mod P with P a parabolic subgroup, because in this case, P is parabolic, means that P contains a Borel subgroup. And the unipotent radical of a Borel subgroup is always a maximal unipotent subgroup of G. So it's clear from the definition that flag varieties are orospherals. But you have more. Another toy example is the following. You can take use upper triangular matrices with one on the diagonal, and then SL2 mod U is certainly orospherical, and it's isomorphic to A2 minus 0. And then you can consider the SL2 equivalent embeddings of X0. And one can show that you have the trivial one, and otherwise you have five more, so A2, P2, P2 minus 0, which is a fixed point, the blob of A2 and the blob of P2. Okay, when this means that you consider when I say P2 minus 0, it means that I consider A2 embedded in P2. Okay. The reason why people consider orospherical varieties is the following. It is an intermediate class between in the middle between toric varieties and spherical varieties. So toric varieties, you certainly know what they are, at least a bit. They have a very nice combinatorial description, but one drawback of toric varieties is that you don't have many of them. For instance, if you consider smooth projective toric varieties with Picard rank 1, those are interesting when you do Mori theory, you just have the projective space, that's it. On the other hand, you have spherical varieties, which is a much larger class, but then the combinatorial description is not easy, especially for non-experts, okay? But in between, you have orospherical varieties, whose combinatorial description is much easier than in the spherical setting, but still, this class is bigger than the class of toric varieties. For instance, if you consider smooth projective orospherical varieties with Picard rank 1, you have now all the flag varieties, the G mod P with the P maximal parabolic subgroup. And on top of that, you have five families of varieties with three orbits. Those were classified by Pasquier in 2009 and very much studied in a lot of papers since then because they have a lot of interesting properties. One of the family is the family of the odd symplectic Grassmannian, in case you heard that already. Okay, so just this was just to motivate this notion of orospherical varieties. Nice class of G varieties with a nice combinatorial description and many people to play with. Okay, and let me just tell you very, very briefly what the combinatorial description looks like. Orospherical varieties admit combinatorial classification in terms of two kinds of objects. First, you must classify the homogeneous spaces. So you want to classify all the orospherical subgroups of G. So all the possible H such that G mod H is orospherical, meaning that H contains a maximal unipotent subgroup. Such H, they are classified by pairs IM, where I is a subset of the set of simple roots of G, and M is some sublattice, depending on I, of the character lattice of a maximal torus T in G. Okay, this is maybe not so easy if you're not familiar with group with the theory of algebraic groups, but this can really be... this is really explicit, okay? If you give me any reductive algebraic group, you can compute all the possible pairs and you get a full classification of the possibilities for a homogeneous space to be orospherical. And once you know all the possibilities for G mod H, you have to encode the possibilities for the G equivalent embeddings of G mod H, and this is done in terms of combinatorial gadgets called colored fans, okay? So here, if I just get back to this example, I wanted to give just a picture so that you see what it's like. If I take G equals SL2 and if I consider SL2 mod U, then the pair is the empty set and you have to take the full character lattice, which is just isomorphic to Z because SL2 has a maximal torus of rank 1, so XT is Z. And the possible equivalent embeddings correspond to these five colored fans. So here you have a dot on one of the cone. The dot means that the corresponding G orbit is of codimension at least 2. And this is an orbit of codimension 1. And when there is this big circle, it means that you have done a blow up. So here, for instance, this is A2, because here an open orbit plus the zero orbit, which is here. You can blow up, you get the blow up of A2 in zero, which is here. This is P2 minus zero. This is P2, and this is P2 blown up in zero, okay? And thanks to the theory of spherical embeddings and colored fans, you know that there is nothing more. So here it would be easy to check that there is nothing more, but in general, in a higher dimensional situation, it's one way to prove that you understand all the, you classify all the possible equivalent embeddings, okay? And now the result we obtain based upon the work of Uruguin is the following. If X is a holospherical variety with an open orbit G mod H, then X admits an equivalent real structure if and only if the combinatorial invariants of X are stable by the Galois group action. So here I just get back. So one can check, if you do things carefully, that a Galois acts on the set of pairs and it acts on the set of colored fans. And what I'm saying is that for G mod H to have a real structure, you need this. For X to have a real structure, you need this Galois action to preserve the pair IM corresponding to G mod H and then the colored fan corresponding to the embedding of G mod H in X. Okay, but that's not it. You have an extra condition. There is a cohomological obstruction, so you need a certain cohomology class in the H2 Galois of this NG H mod H to vanish. And here I should mention that since X is holospherical, H is a holospherical subgroup, and in this case one can check that NG H mod H is a torus. So you can consider the second Galois group cohomology. It is well defined because here you have an abelian group. Okay, so this completely answers the first question. Does there exist or not a real structure on X? And now for the second question, we also have a complete answer. When a real structure exists, we know that there are exactly 2 to the power of d equivalent real structures up to equivalence, where I cannot give you a d with a nice formula, but d can be computed algorithmically anyway. Okay, so if you give me the combinatorial invariance corresponding to x, then I can compute this d in a reasonable amount of time with a computer software. Okay. And here I should mention that a couple of months after the release of our article, so on the archive it was released in 2018, Borovoy and Gagliardi, using the work of Uruguin and Vedhorn, they generalized the existence part of our theorem to the case where X is a spherical variety over any base field of characteristic zero. Okay. But they don't generalize the second part, which is more tricky if you consider arbitrary fields. But here, over a field of characteristic zero, they get the exact same result. So this criterion generalizes such as. And also, in our paper with Lucy, we then applied this result in the case of smooth projective holospherical varieties with Picard rank 1, and we obtained a complete classification of the equivalent real structure. In particular, we prove that when there is a real form, there is at most one. Okay, and we know exactly which one have a real form. Okay, so that's it for holospherical varieties. Okay. So now I would like to move on and discuss a bit the case of equivalent embeddings of SL2 mod H.
Sorry, can I ask a question?
Yes.
This integer d, do you know which integers can appear? Can every positive integer?
Any non-negative integer can appear.
Okay, thank you.
And the fact that you have a power of 2 here, it's not, it can be a bit surprising if you are not familiar with the subject, but in fact, it simply follows from the fact that the Galois group is Z mod 2Z. So as soon as the H1 is finite, if you put an abelian group in it, then you are looking at it's just a group theory. Okay, it's, I will say something wrong, but it's just basic group theory to see that you must get two groups in the sense P group. So the cardinal must be a power of 2 because all the others that do not play a role with the Galois group action.
Okay. Right. Yes. Thanks.
And so now let me discuss. So here, the case of spherical varieties, at least for the existence part, it's all done. It's well known, well understood. Spherical varieties, I didn't say what it is because it's not useful for me, but let me tell it now. Those are G varieties on which, so you have a reductive group action, G acting on X, and you want a dense open orbit for G, but also for a Borel subgroup P. When you have this, you say that the variety is spherical and you have a very well established combinatorial description and a lot of results concerning the geometry of these varieties. They are also called of complexity zero, meaning that the general B orbit is of codimension one, codimension zero. And then, from the classification point of view, once this case is understood, the next case to look at is the case where a B orbit, general B orbit, is of codimension one. Okay, from a combinatorial point of view, this is the second step. And so this is what we do here. We consider almost homogeneous SL2 threefolds with a dense open orbit for the action of SL2. SL2 is of dimension 3. So if you act on a threefold with a dense open orbit, the open orbit must be of the form SL2 mod H with H a finite subgroup. And so in particular, a Borel subgroup in SL2 is of codimension 1. So a Borel subgroup will act on X0. A general B orbit will be of codimension one. So this is a complexity one case. It's not spherical. Okay, that's all I want to say. It's not spherical, but that's just the step after spherical varieties. You have complexity one varieties, and this is the first case to consider. And that's why it's nice to have a look at those varieties. And here it's well known that the finite subgroups of SL2, they are. They are well known since more than one century. They were classified by Klein, I think. You have ADE type. So A means the type E is cyclic groups. D means the binary dihedral groups. And for E, you have E6, E7, E8. Those correspond to the binary polyhedral groups. So you have three conjugacy classes, and you can give explicit representative for each conjugacy class. Okay. So this part of the class, I mean, the possible SL2 mod H, it's easy. And now I fix a real group structure on SL2. You just have two up to equivalence. You have SL2 of R and SU2. And then in this direction, the result we obtain with Lucy is the following. We obtain a complete classification of the equivalent real structure on the homogeneous SL2 threefold. And we describe the real loci. So here it is, we have a table with a case by case. We did it case by case, looking at all the possibilities for H, and we have an explicit list I will show you just after. And then, once you know all the real structure on the open orbit, the second step is to see which one extend. And this we are also able to do it, because given an equivalent real structure mu0 on X0, we obtain a combinatorial criterion to determine whether mu0 extend to an equivalent real structure mu on X. And when it extends, we have a criterion. I mean, it's part of the criterion. We know when the quotient is an algebraic variety and not just an algebraic space. So you have two things. First, you want to know, does this mu zero extend or not? And when it extends, you want to know whether the quotient is an algebraic variety and not just an algebraic space. And this can be done combinatorially. So this is something we have done in this setting, and more generally, we have a similar result over any perfect Bessel field for any almost homogeneous variety. But here we have a very explicit list only in the case of SL2 mod H. And as a corollary of this, so for all spherical varieties, we obtain a classification of the real structure on smooth projective orospherical variety with Picard rank 1. I told you they have very nice geometric features. For instance, they play an important role in Mori theory. Here we did something analogous. Indeed, we consider the minimal smooth completion of SL2 mod H when h is of type d or e. So we did not treat the case where h is cyclic for technical reasons, just because you have more computations to do, but the same strategy apply. And what we prove is that if you have edge binary dihedral group of order 4, I think, I'm not sure, I never remember whether it's 4 or 8 the order, but then X admits exactly two equivalent real structures, so two non-isomorphic real forms, but in all other cases, you have a unique one. This is something we prove. So this is it seems to be a general observation that each time we are looking at a real structure on a minimal variety, in the sense that we smooth projective with a Picard rank one, then there is always at most one real form. So I don't know whether it's a general fact or not, but this is something worth to be noticed. And so here I would like to first show you what this table looks like, and then to say a few words about this. So first, the table. It's not to scare you, just to give you an idea what it looks like. So on the left, you have H. So we are considering the real structure on SL2 mod H. So here you have A1 is the trivial group. This is a cyclic group of order 2 and of order n. And this is a binary dihedral group, and you have E6, E7, E8. Here we consider the case where the sigma that you take is sigma S, which is S for split. So this is SL2 of R acting. And here you get you take sigma C, C for compact. So here it's SU2 acting. And in each case, so for instance here, I take SL2 mod AN with N at least 4. Then you have three inequivalent G sigma S equivalent real structure on X0. And I gave you a representative of each equivalence classes, and here a description of the real locus. And you can see that sometimes it's empty, in which case the corresponding real form is not rational. And otherwise, I think that in all these cases, when the real locus is not empty, it is always a rational variety over R, even if the real locus is not connected, but it's just that we are considering something which is not compact. So when you take the compactification, the real locus, it becomes connected. So there is no contradiction so far. Okay. So this is what it looks like. You can see that for SU2, you have a very nice uniform description, empty or SU2 mod H. But for SL2 mod H with sigma S, the description of the real locus, it requires some work. Okay. And now I wanted to say a few words about the minimal smooth completion of the SL2 mod DN. Maybe it seems a bit abstract, but in fact, you know some of them, I'm sure of this. For instance, if you consider the binary dihedral group, then there is a unique minimal smooth completion. So if you take D4, the minimal smooth completion is the projectivization of the tangent bundle. If you take D5, the X that you obtain is just a P3, where SL2 act on P3 considered as a P of R3, where R3 are the binary forms of degree 3 with a classical action of SL2. And if you take H equals Dn with n at least 6, then the corresponding minimal smooth completion is a projectivization of the so-called Schwarzenberger vector bundles over P2. And this rank 2 vector bundle is very important it appears in a lot of papers in algebraic geometry, because those are vector bundles with a lot of nice symmetries and nice properties. You projectivize them, you get a P1 bundle over P2, and it is one of our minimal smooth completions. Okay. And in fact, here it's not written, but if you take now E6, E7, or E8, then the minimal smooth completions that you obtain are the smooth quadric in P4, the Fano threefold V5, and the Mukai Umemura Fano threefold V22, which are also very famous, very important, and very interesting for many reasons when you work with Fano varieties or when you do Mori theory. Okay, and here, let me just show you what the combinatorial description of an equivalent embedding of SL2 mod H looks like. So such a combinatorial description is due to Luna Wüst in the founding paper of 76. And it is very similar to the description in terms of fans for toric varieties, or in terms of colored fan for spherical varieties. You have spiders with infinitely many legs, and each spider represents an embedding of SL2 mod H. So for instance, if you take H equals D4, the corresponding spider is this one. And here the spider corresponding to this embedding of SL2 mod H is this one. So you have three long legs. All the other are short legs of size 1/2. The other have size 1. And you can see that you have two legs among three with a mark. And in fact, what will happen if you go into detail is that the Galois group, Z mod 2Z, will act on this spider by permuting the legs of the same length. So it will permute the short legs, but here they are all the same, so it does not matter. And it will permute the long legs. And if you permute the two long legs with a mark, or if you do nothing, then the real structure on SL2 mod H will extend to X. But if the Galois action permits a long leg with a mark and a long leg with no mark, then it's not okay. It means that the real structure does not extend, okay? So that's a bit similar to what happens for toric varieties, in which case you will have a Galois group action on the set of toric of cones. And if you exchange the cones of the fan, then you can extend the real structure. Otherwise, you have an obstruction. And here it's the same kind of phenomenon, okay? The same holds here. Now you have one long leg, so it's fixed. You have two legs of size 2/3. So these two legs can be exchanged. And either gamma acts trivially on both of them, then it's okay. You can extend the real structure from the open orbit to the whole X. Or gamma exchanges the two long legs, in which case you have an obstruction, and so on here. Okay, so this is what I mean when I say that we have an explicit combinatorial criterion to determine whether mu zero extends or not. This can be seen from this spider diagram. Okay, and to see whether the quotient is an algebraic variety, this can also be seen on the skeleton on the spider diagram, but it's more complicated to explain. Okay. To finish, I would like to mention two possible lines of research in the same vein of what I just told you, in the continuity of our work. So the spherical case, so the complexity zero case, is more or less understood. At least there is a complete answer to the first question, which is about the existence of real structures. And for the second questions, I think it's hopeless to look for a complete answer in general. It will always be a case by case answer. At least that's my feeling. But now we can still try to answer the first question for other class of algebraic varieties endowed with an algebraic group action. And I think the next class to consider is the one of complexity 1 G varieties, which englobes the one of almost homogeneous SL2 3-4 that I mentioned. And for this class, working over any perfect base field extend our results. So determine when there is a descent datum or not, when it is effective, and try in some cases to compute the number of possible descent data up to equivalence. So this could certainly be done using the combinatorial description of such varieties due to Timoshev. And in another direction, one can forget about almost homogeneous varieties, and we could apply the combinatorial description due to Altman and Hausen, and Altman-Hausen-Suess in the non-affine case, to classify and study the variety endowed with a torus action over any perfect base field. So in particular, you have the toric case inside, but you can also consider tori acting not with an tori that does not act with an open orbit. And then there is still a combinatorial description, which is more involved, but it exists. And there is actually Pierre-Alexandre Gillard, so who is a PhD student, whom I jointly supervise with Adrien Duboulot, who is working in this direction. So I just wanted to mention this other line of research if you are more interested in tea actions with tea authors. Okay, and that's basically all I wanted to say. So thank you for your attention.
Okay, thank you very much. So we can thank the speaker. Put your mic on or to use a reaction with this applause. And okay. Then, okay, is there any questions? So put your mic on if you have any question.
I'm sure it was crystal clear.
Yeah, it was. I agree. But I was aware of a part of the talk. Okay. Yes.
I have a question. So you mentioned that the question in of cases with infinitely many real structures was very recent. So what was... why did it take so long? What was the new idea that made it possible to find the example in that direction, would you say?
I think that, I mean, probably Frédéric knows this topic better than me, but I would say there are two main reasons. First, people started to really consider, to use this point of view and to be interested in this problem, I think, very recently. I mean, it appears in the literature since a long time, but in a systematic way, it's very recent, I think. And also, it's what you have to do to prove that you have infinitely many non-isomorphic real forms. You need to understand the group of components, so ot x mod ot 0 x, and this group is quite complicated. In the affine case, it's slightly easier because this group is very big. But in the projective case, O0X is a linear algebra. I mean, it's an algebraic group, connected algebraic group. So here, this part will not. If you just consider the O0X, the H1 gamma O0X is always finite. This is a result, I think, due to Serre. So to prove that you have infinitely many non-isomorphic real forms, it really relies on understanding the group of components. And this group can be very complicated. But it's not so easy to produce examples where this group is complicated enough. I don't know whether I'm clear. You want this to be not of finite type and with very specific features.
Yes, I understand. Thanks.
You see what I mean? It's not easy to. I mean, people know what they need, but to really be able to produce the variety with such properties, it's this is very striking in the case of projective rational surfaces. This was done to have an example where you have infinitely many non-isomorphic real forms. This was done this year. This was done during the spring or even the summer. I don't know, but like some months ago. Before that, it was an open question because it's complicated to understand this group of components. At least that's my feeling, but maybe Frédéric has another point of view on this.
No, your explanation was quite good. There were some attempts to produce such kind of examples in the 80s, but first examples were very recent, in fact, yes.
Yeah, I think there is more motivation.
Question was exactly people, to produce this group of a big group of components. And which, yes, as you say, it's not sufficient.
I remember that there was recently some work by Ogiso and Dino.
Yes.
Also constructed using K3 surfaces, right?
Yes, exactly.
Yes.
I'm sorry, maybe you mentioned it, but I didn't hear it. So that's why.
It was mentioned, yes.
Yes, you're right. This was mentioned. It's a recent work where they were proving that you have infinitely many non-isomorphic real forms. I think they prove it for in any dimension, at least two.
Yes, exactly. Is there any other question? So please put your mic on and ask. if you have any. Okay, if there is no question, we can thank the speaker again. So again, you can put your mic on to clap.
Thank you very much.
Okay. Okay. Bye-bye to all. Next time.
Bye. Bye.
See you.
Thank you for joining. So sorry, Frédéric, it was a bit redundant with what you saw.
No, it was okay. when we put the talk on ZAG, it was not. On peut parler français. Je n'avais pas encore les dates. Enfin, je savais pas que j'allais écouter la même chose juste avant. Salut Slava, je te vois. Faut que tu mettes ton micro. Je t'entends pas.
Ok,
je t'entends.
Yeah.
Oui.
Maybe take 2 minutes break.
Sure.
I will be back in 2 minutes.
Ok. En fait, Slava m'a demandé de faire des essais parce qu'il doit parler la semaine prochaine.
Ok.
Il m'a demandé de faire des essais, c'est pour ça.
Voilà. Ok. Bah, je vais vous laisser. Moi, je restais juste au cas où quelqu'un veut discuter.
Ok. Moi, j'ai une question. Je ne voulais pas poser forcément comme ça. Si juste savoir si tu avais eu le temps de réfléchir un petit peu sur les trucs. Parce que là, tu as bien expliqué les complétions projectives là, des quasi-homogènes sous SL2. Ça, c'est ouais. Ce dont on avait parlé. Ça, c'est cool. Et je voulais savoir juste si tu avais eu le temps de regarder dans d'autres directions.
Non, c'est juste ce que j'ai regardé, c'est que justement que les composantes connexes que j'obtenais là, quand je prenais la complétion, j'ai vérifié qu'elles s'intersectaient. Ça m'a déjà pris pas mal de temps, mais j'en sais rien.
Je comprends. C'est déjà pas mal. Parce que nous, on reprendra la discussion à un autre moment, mais nous, on a avancé un petit peu avec Andrea, donc je te raconterai.
Ah,
sur
cool.
Les intersections de quadriques et les choses comme ça. Voilà.
Ah là là, tu mets la pression là, faut que je...
C'était exprès. À bientôt, Ronan.
Ah, merci beaucoup, Frédéric.
Salut, merci pour ton exposé. Salut.
Salut.
Bon.
Alors, allons-y, qu'est-ce que tu veux faire comme essai, précisément?
Je ne sais pas comment ça marche.
J'ai fait tout à l'heure pour Ronan, je vais te mettre co-animateur.
Voilà. Donc,
et là, normalement, tu auras le droit de partager ton écran ou de faire des choses comme ça.
Et où je trouve partager l'écran?
Alors, je pense que sur le mien, c'est en bas. Il y a une barre de... Quand tu bouges ta souris, il y a des choses qui apparaissent, des commandes qui apparaissent.
Partager, non, je vois. OK. Partager.
Il doit y avoir un menu. Ah, il faudrait peut-être que j'arrête l'enregistrement, d'ailleurs.